Thanks all for coming to the city. My name is Gene Livingston. I'm the president of the Celebrate Granite City group. We have several people here that are not with our group. Our mission, both of you have our pamphlet, and I appreciate it if you'd come to our next meeting. It'll be next month, third Tuesday, right, ladies? And it will be at the library. We usually meet at, what, 6:30?
6:30.
Third Tuesday of next month at 6:30 at the library. Tonight's discussion, this is actually our first field trip, isn't it?
Educational
field trip.
History.
We want to thank, and we'll get to the curator of this building.
Oh, you're looking for education.
Thank you, Larry. Thank you, Larry. We are standing in Granite City's, is it?
The original.
This is the original because I was going to ask that question. We're going to get this on film about the fire station over on Rock Road and Cayuga?
Cayuga, yeah.
Is that the original?
This is.
Was this here before this?
Oh, wait a minute.
It was City Hall.
So this was here before that one was?
Oh, yeah.
Building was built in 1904.
We're in the, thank you, Larry, I'm going to introduce that. Why don't you come on up here? Larry Zotti is the owner and curator of this building. He leases this building from the city.
Yeah.
Right? The city actually owns this property. The city actually owns this property. Larry leases it from them for, I'm not going to tell you how much it is, but.
No, when I tried to buy it, it all of a sudden became worth a lot of money.
Yeah.
Imagine that.
When I was interested in it, they were going to tear it down. So, figured it out.
But this talk this evening is going to be about some of the history of the Granite City Fire Department. And we are standing in the first fire station. And Larry is not a firefighter, but Larry is a collector of fire memorabilia. And the camera is not showing that right now, but we are standing here with three fire trucks and loads of pictures and gear and equipment around this room. And I'm going to let Larry try to explain some of it, and I'll turn this over to Larry Zotti. Thank you.
No problem. Glad you all could make it. Really appreciate you guys coming down. I'll make this short as I can, because I know the other guys have got a lot of stories to tell, and I know that Art and Lenny are like myself, that once the mouth starts working, it does not stop easily. So the building itself was built in 1904. It was originally, as Art was saying, it was originally the Granite City City Hall and the fire department and the police department all in one building. The police department was actually in the back where that white truck is parked in the back. This was naturally the firehouse. Upstairs were the city council offices and chambers. This was a horse house. They had horse-drawn apparatus in here prior to any motorized apparatus. So it goes way back. There are photos on a wall up here while I'm thinking of it showing the horse-drawn apparatus. One of those is showing the wagon at the St. Louis World's Fair in 1904. So the guys were proud. They got around a little bit. The building was used until the new city hall was built on Niedring House. And at that time, it was converted over to just strictly the fire department. So the fire department used it from roughly, I believe, 1929 until 1961, when they closed down this engine house and they moved to the current Station 1. It's at 23rd Madison Avenue, which I have pictures of that over here when it was being built, if anybody wants to see those. After the fire department moved out of this building, civil defense came in here, and they were in here until 1991. And at that time, kind of jump off on another track here for a minute, I'd already been collecting these fire engines. That was my first one that I bought. My dad and I restored it from National City Stockyards. But I got in that truck in 1985, then I picked up another one, and then I picked up this truck, which this is the first fire engine that the Granite City Fire Department owned and bought when they organized the department into a pay department in 1922. this truck is sitting in its original spot is the day it was delivered in 1922. But anyway, I was looking for a place to park these two trucks at the time. And I was driving by here one day on the way downtown here, and I saw the building, and I was thinking, my God, it's sitting there empty. And gears started turning a little bit, so I talked to a couple of my acquaintances that were on the city council at the time, and we worked out a little program to get me into the building, so to speak. And like I said, my initial thought was to try to buy it, but they didn't want to do that. So I do have a lease for about 175 years on it. And anyway, that's how I ended up getting into this building. So I came in here, I got the building in 1992. And the city did help me out with some funding to do the renovation, which is now 23 years old, so it looks a little worn, as you can see. We did, we acid washed the outside of the building, they sealed it, tuck pointing, did the inside, painted the floors. This was all repainted and whatnot. The building itself, you can see, it's still got a little charm to it. I mean, the engine room down here is, this is the crux of the place. The upstairs, I was telling Norma a while ago, the upstairs was, they kind of beat the tar out of it, so to speak. So the back end is, there's no really visible appearance to it that's original. You wouldn't be able to detect anything from the original part of the building. This part up here, they used as the dorm, the fire department did, but then civil defense, when they got in here, they paneled it all off and put a drop ceiling and a whole nine yards, so it's all modernized. So it kind of loses its effect. But this down here, this is the original tin ceiling that was in here. The lights are original. I mean, everything you see in here is original. The doors, the glass. It's not changed much since it was put in here, you know, since the building was built. When it was a horse house, there were stables to the back, like right before you go into that opening deck. That opening actually was not there. There was a man door. And when they bought a truck in 1922, there was a ladder truck that was too long to fit in the building. So they ended up knocking a hole in that wall back there is how that got there. But that area right over there to the rear where that pumper is sitting, there was a small stable or a corral where they kept the horses. There are actually some indentations in the concrete under that truck that I can show you. I was told this by an old timer many years ago, and he'd been on the fire department many years ago. And he said that the story is that those indentations are where the horses would stand, and they'd constantly have a little rocking back and forth, I guess, because they were always ready to go. I'm not an equestrian, so I don't know that much about that stuff. But anyway, that's, you know, a little tidbit of information about the indentations in the floor. Who's got questions? Because I'm going rapid fire here. I'm trying to think of anybody got anything? You got anything? You
guys? No, I would have just added that. I might have just added that Granite City was incorporated into a city in 1896 and was a volunteer fire department until 1922 when they became unionized.
Yeah.
And that's when they bought this first truck. Now, Lenny's, we have another speaker that's going to come up that has some great stories about this truck.
Can I tell my quick story on the truck?
Sure, absolutely. It's all part of the history.
I was talking earlier that this truck and I have kind of gone full history in our lifetime. My grandparents lived about three doors from the old engine house on Namioki Road back when I'm going back into the...
Some people might not know where that building is.
Yeah, that's
a little more specific.
Firehouse, bar, grill, taco.
I'm going to in a second.
Sorry.
right behind O'Brien Tire, that brick building that's now Nick's Bar and Grill. That used to be a Granite City firehouse. It was actually part of the village of Namioki, and they incorporated in 1948, or they annexed Namioke in 1948. And at that time, it became a Granite City fire station. It was an outlying station. When I was growing up in the 50s, my grandparents, like I said, they lived about three doors from there, and I used to walk down the street and spend hours on this truck just sitting up in the seat playing. So I got it. I've been intimate with this thing since, you know, I was a small boy. And in 1987, I started thinking about it after I'd had this truck, and I also have a hook and ladder. And I had those two trucks, and I started thinking about what happened to this. And I had remembered an article in the Granite City Press Record where they had given it to one of the universities up north. It ended up going to Illinois State University. Mayor Davis gave it to the city gave it to them for a dollar. A silver dollar is what they paid for it. Hi, David. But anyway, I started trying to track it down, and I went down to the library, and I was trying to pinpoint when about that was, this, that, and the other, because I couldn't remember which university it was, to tell you the truth. And within about 15 minutes, I found this photograph, because I was going just on where I thought I was age-wise at the time. But anyway, make a long story short, my cousin was going to school up there. I called him that day. Within 2 hours, he had an answer where this thing was. It was over in Peoria in a man's barn, a farmer's barn, and all that was there was the chassis, the frame, four wheels and tires, and the hose box on the back end. That's it. And everything else was in bushel baskets. So, like a fool, I went up and bought it, and it took my dad it took us 4.5 years, basically what we did, we laid it out in the garage floor, we just looked at it as a big model kit, figured out what we had, what we didn't have, and away we went. So, Lenny, are you going to tell about the accident at 28? You want to tell that part?
We'll ask him that when he gets up here.
Sharp and I got killed?
Yeah. You want to tell that one?
Ask him that when he gets up here. That could be one of the questions you can ask.
Okay. Well, I got the story, but I figured he'd want to tell that. So
there's a couple of the stories I want to tell about this.
Yeah.
Too.
That's why I want to. Yeah. I don't know whether to keep going or shut up.
Well, I could take over for you if you want.
Well, I knew you could talk for a long time. That's why I want you to go last, because you can fill in any time that we had left.
But, okay.
And you can come back.
Yeah.
And talk
right,
again.
Well, wait, this is
let's go on to Lenny. And while Lenny, why don't you come up here while I'm introducing you? Because a little story about the gentleman that just walked in and involves you. You just retired when?
A year ago, May.
One of the things he did while he was at the fire department, and Art and I helped him out a couple of times, was Lenny was in charge of our Explorer program, if you know what the Explorers are.
Boy Scout.
Boy Scout, yeah, okay. While we had a post at the department, the gentleman just walked in as Dave Cook and his son. Dave Cook was a member of that one of those Explorer classes that Lenny had, but Dave Cook is also now a Granite City firefighter.
First one hired
out of the Explorer group. There's several in there.
Yeah, there's.
He got the nickname.
Eddie Connolly.
He got the nickname. He got the nickname Boy Scout because.
Yeah, but, and it was thanks to these guys that I was able to take firefighter classes prior to being able to get some experience in order to get hired.
You can't take fire science classes of any kind.
Never be trained as a firefighter unless you're affiliated with a fire department. The local communities around us are all volunteer, and they have these kids that were sent into school, and these kids were getting EMT training, paramedic training, firefighter training, and then they're getting hired by the Granite City Fire Department from outside communities. Well, none of the Granite City kids had a chance. So when I went to the school and asked them, how can I get our kids in there, because my son wanted to be, and he's friends with my son, and they said, well, you know, start a Boy Scout program, the Explorers, and that makes them affiliated with the fire department. So we did. We got Dave Brinkmeyer, Ed Connolly.
Lindsey Hendricks.
Lindsey was part of it.
Now that's just on this department, but Burris.
Burris, Alan Watson, Griffith.
Yeah, you got
they're it. All yeah. Departments. And departments down in Kentucky, East St. Louis. I mean, they're all over the place. So we ended up because of that program, 7 or 8 kids got to be firefighters. So
yeah, before I turn
that wouldn't have been otherwise.
Yeah, Mike, go ahead.
Do they still have that program?
No, the program. My personal life, I had to step away. Art took over for quite a few years. And then the interest wasn't there. The kids dropped off, and it just we had to do away.
Just did it at a good time where those kids that joined were interested in it, but kind of dropped off because they come from the high school. We let the high school when it you kind of let the high school, the principal, and that know that we're looking for, and they kind of help filter those kids to us.
Right.
Yeah. Before I turn you loose, there's something I want to say. Back in. I'm retired from the fire department, but I was never a firefighter. And you ask, well, how can that be? When I joined the ambulance service back in 1984. The ambulance service belonged to the fire department, but they didn't have the firefighter paramedic program yet. That didn't become an ordinance until 1986. What are you pointing at? Art making a mess? Well, you got to feed the mice too. No, don't worry about it. So for 2 years, I worked on that ambulance, and I never, the cutoff for becoming a firefighter is age 35. When I started in 84, I was 33. I was kind of, okay, so I never became a firefighter. They grandfathered me and two other guys in 1986 when they created that ordinance, firefighter paramedic. So my whole career was on the ambulance, which was kind of unique. And as these guys will tell you, at the end of my career, I was probably the highest paid paramedic in Illinois, only because I was riding the coattails of the firefighters union. Private service didn't get paid as much as the union guys. And I did that for 23 and a half years. So that's part of the history of the fire department, the ambulance service, and we may talk more about the ambulance service later. And I ended up being a paramedic. I started out as an EMT, but Lenny Wilson retired after how many years?
34 years, 8 months and 3 days.
He retired as a shift commander when? Recently.
May 4th of last year.
Yeah. So you were the last one. Nobody's went since you, right?
I don't think so. Johnny
Other
Bell,
than Connie
Johnny Bell retired the day before I did.
Yeah,
and then since then, Jim Snelson, the chief and assistant chief, has stepped down.
Yeah.
They retired. So.
Yeah, we have a new first chief and assistant chief we've had that came on the job after me. So I think that's kind of neat. But, that just shows Vince Martinez is the new chief, and
Kenny Prasman
is the new assistant chief. Yeah. Both of those.
So, Lenny, you got a couple of stories. Why don't you talk about the accident?
I just got the one story. Yeah. This truck is kind of unique. Like Larry said, my dad started on the fire department in 1946. My dad was Leonard Wilson. 1946, he started on the fire department. The first truck he rode on was his truck. He was a pipeman, young pipeman, they call him. That's what he did. He was the first one to ride on the truck. Well, my dad passed away in 2011, and Larry took my dad's casket to the graveyard in this truck. So this truck was the first truck and the last truck that my dad ever rode on, fire truck. So, kind of a unique story. But this truck was also involved in an accident in 1928. Charbonnier?
Yeah.
Charbonnier was riding, and the bell, as you can see on the side of it, it swings. Well, they were going to a fire down in Iowa, about 2700 block of Iowa, and he had swung the bell out and was clanging it. That's what they did. They would clang it. And a lady backed out of her driveway. The truck swerved to keep from hitting her, and the tires caught the curb, and it flipped over, and the bell on the Eagle went through his chest and killed him. So he was the only on-duty fire death in Granite City, other than, I think it was Floyd Bell, who had got off work that morning, was driving home, and had a heart attack and died on the way home. So, but, technically, I guess he's still on duty till he gets home. I don't know, or maybe he isn't.
Yeah, I don't know if this ever changed our hours, but we worked from 7 in the morning till 7 the next morning. So, like we said before, we slept at the station. That was our home for 24 hours. Then he were off 48.
And then there's a story that I think Larry ought to tell, too, is the type of lanterns that are on these trucks are Dietz lanterns. And you were missing one, Larry?
Yeah.
And he was working with your Uncle Leonard?
I was out at his house.
Good job,
at his house.
Good job,
and he's telling him, you know, Uncle Leonard, if you're ever at these swap meets or whatever, and you can find a Dietz lantern, would you please pick it up? Because I need one for this truck. And I think his uncle told him, said, well, I have one up in my attic. And so Larry got up there, and it was the Dietz lantern that originally was on this truck.
It was one on the bottom. And my father, my uncle, my dad's uncle, worked on the street department many years ago.
So I guess somehow he ended up with the lantern. He gave it to my uncle. It was in his rafters, and I, out of the clear blue sky, I'm out there with my dad one Saturday morning. He tells me to crawl up and... Uncle says, crawl up and get the lantern down, and it had GCFD number one scratched in the bottom of it, and that was that truck. And I had the same experience in Smokey Joe's Tavern in Pontoon Beach. Two of the ex-chiefs used to own the tavern, and Perenny and, or not, Joe Holder. Owned the tavern, and they had it decorated on the inside with hose and all kinds of paraphernalia from the fire department. There was a nozzle hanging up there, and I'm sitting there looking at that nozzle one night while I'm at the bar, and I was a beer salesman for 25 years, so that's what I was doing, sitting in the bar, by the way. But anyway,
well, I got to throw it in there to clear myself somehow.
But anyway. I was looking up at that nozzle, and I asked the bartender, I said, can I crawl up there in the back bar and look at that nozzle? And it was a nozzle off of his truck. And it just, I mean, really weird little things like that. You know, that's why I say this truck and I have come full circle on, in my lifetime anyway, in its lifetime. It's 90 years old, so.
And it's amazing to find. I mean, if you look at this truck, the detail on it, like these bells on these trucks, those are hard to find. People want these bells, and Larry's sitting right in front of one there, but they make a really distinctive
sound.
Oh,
yeah,
they're distinctive, hard to, we haven't clanged one yet tonight. But.
And another, I got another story about this truck. My dad said that when they used to respond to fires, that's a chain-driven truck. Like a bicycle chain, you know, you ride your bike and the chain pops off. Well, he said they look like...
if you're capable...
Keystone firemen, because they would go to the fire. And there's a box, I think, back there that has the mallet and the links and everything. And the chain would pop off, and it would break. And they would have to stop, jump off the truck, put the chain back on, put the links back on, beat it back together, and then go to the fire.
So you said it was, they actually called that a chain box. Even in the truck, in the specs from the factory, so it's a chain box.
If you're capable of getting down and looking under there, it's kind of neat to see that, because you don't see that on many vehicles.
It's not neat to work on, but it's...
But I don't really have any more stories about that truck.
This time, because then the three of you, or the four of us, Dave may even have some stories since he's here, but I'm going to introduce Art Asadorian, who had how many years on the job?
33 years, 10 months, and 2 days.
Not that we counted
while we were on. Art retired as a captain, but I got to tell a story about him. Art was one of the first firefighter paramedics in 86 when they... made that ordinance to be a firefighter paramedic. Art did his paramedic training at that time in Wood River. That's who was over all the paramedics. And when he became a paramedic, and of course that was, we were some of the first in the state.
Yeah.
You were given a paramedic number.
By region.
By region. And our region, being his last name starts with?
An A.
He was P1. Okay, I was like P60 something, I think, by the time I got mine, but which still isn't a lot by the time, you know, that was in 77.
I never was a P, so.
Yeah, the paramedic program started in 77, and I didn't come on until 84, so my number still wasn't that high, and now they're into the three digits or whatever, but Art retired as a captain, and since he was both, I'm sure he has a plethora of stories that he can tell also.
Well, you know, and thank you. Lenny and Larry were talking about this becoming a paid department in 1922. In 1923, they became a unionized department, and our union number is 253. Currently, the last number issued, I think I read in one of the retired firefighter magazines, was 2,988 or somewhere around there, just under 3,000. And that just shows you how early and how long this has been a union fire department.
Yeah, number one is?
Number one is, hold on.
I'll say Cincinnati.
Cincinnati, and then Nashville, and then Chicago's number four.
Somewhere in the area.
Yeah. I mean, we are up there with the big boys,
yeah.
In all honesty. But, you know, the department went on. I mean, like Larry said, they operated out of here. But you got to remember, when this was built, Granite City didn't go past 23rd Street. So this was the area they covered, right here. And then as we progressed and as we grew, then naturally the department grew. Currently they have three stations, a main station and two outlying stations.
About 50 guys.
And in 19, and I'm going to tell you about a couple of major incidents that we had. One was in 1953. They called it the Great Lincoln Place Fire. And when our department responded, at that night, the Madison County firefighters were actually meeting in Venice at the Venice Fire Station. They're having their monthly meeting. Our department responded over a phone call. A phone call was made to the chief. You come, you see. That's what the person told the chief. You come.
He called the fire department first.
Yeah.
And said, where's the chief? He wanted to talk to the chief. And they said, he's all having lunch or something.
Yeah.
Or supper.
Supper.
And he said, okay, I'll call. And they hung, and he hung up and he called the chief at home.
She said, what do you want? He said, you come, you see. He said, what? He said, you come, you see. The chief drives down to Lincoln Place, sees at the back of the, which building was it, Norma? Across the street from Grandpa's Tavern. Cole building was on fire. He borrows a nickel to call the fire department to respond to the fire. While the wind shifted, it ended up catching several buildings on fire. It became national news. My mom even had some articles, I believe, from a newspaper in Florida, the LA Times, and, you know, I mean, all over about the Great Lincoln Place Fire. Lenny.
Real quick, that album that I have over there has about probably 10 or 11 pictures of the Lincoln Place Fire.
Right. And unfortunately, that was the plug that was there was the last plug on the line. So the water pressure was close to nil. So they had to bring in the deluge gun from the Army depot. That was, so anyway, after several hours, they were able to get the fire out.
Kind of like that.
Oh, it was just a ball.
A lot of people don't know what a deluge gun is.
Yeah, this is a deluge gun, but it was mounted to a truck.
Yeah.
And they were actually sucking water.
Sometimes they call it a cannon.
Out of portable tanks to, you know. So that was the first major fire. You know, we've had several large fires, but the second major fire was in 2001, 2002, the warehouse.
It's right here on the board.
Yeah, what's the date on it? Anyways, everybody remembers the large warehouse on Needering House Avenue. And
that made sense.
I got the call at 5:05 in the morning, called out, and Matt Gasparovic, who was on duty at the time, I answered the phone. I said, hello, and he says, you come, you see. And I got to tell you, it scared the hell out of me. I said, what do we got? And he said, the warehouse. And Lenny and I, you know, were on the original call on that. Me, Lenny, and actually Danny Green went down there, and it was like, what are we going to do with this truck?
Yeah.
But go ahead, Lenny.
My dad was still alive at the time. And when I was growing up, the old firefighters used to say, if we ever get the Vandalia warehouse, it's the big one. It's going to be the big one. It's going to be the big one. And we got to where, when we'd get a call or something, somebody would say, oh, it's Vandalia Warehouse, we'd all laugh, you know? And then that day, when they said, you come, you see, that's Mark knew immediately it was Vandalia Warehouse.
Even I got called out at 5:30 in the morning, and you wonder, why you called and not a firefighter? Well,
because I was on the ambulance. The ambulance still has to be maintained. Though my partner, a lot of times, was always a firefighter, and if they had to go to a fire, I'd just stand around and watch them. But that's why I would get called. But I can remember standing out, if you remember where Hutchings, our Brandy service station, was at, standing by his pumps, looking at the front door of that warehouse, you know, it went this way. And that front door was right there, and there was propane tanks stored in there for whatever reason, but they started exploding one at a time. And heading towards the tracks. So it was like, I mean, I've never seen anything like that, but it was watching that fire all day long. Just
it was interesting.
Down
it was interesting.
It was more fire than we had water for.
Actually, yes. The part of the building that's still standing, two people showed up at 6 o'clock in the morning.
ATF.
And told the shift commanders, under all means, you will save that part of the building, whatever it takes.
One of them.
You will save that part of the building.
One of them told Tim, said, put the fire out. Put it out now.
Yeah.
As it turns out.
Who the hell are you? He was FBI or something. Yeah. He said, we have evidence in that building. You got to put that fire out now. Yeah.
And as it turns out, at the time, they've moved it since then, but they were storing all the evidence for the Noriega case. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was all being stored right there in Granite City, and you know, who would have thought, right? But anyway, so those were our two major fires. Like I said, we've had several large fires. The George Lindsay fire, as it says here,
Reese's.
You know, a man on fire, that's how the call came in. There's a man on fire. Somebody went into Jack in the Box, Burger King, and said, George Lindsay's burning. So one of the four-hour-an-hour employees picked up the phone and called the fire department and said, there was a man on fire. Okay, well, it was George Lindsay's restaurant. So anyway, but getting back to the history, you know, we're going to fast forward to 1977 when I think the department really made a drastic change. There's a political battle going on, and the guy running for mayor at the time was running an ambulance service. And I guess he thought he was going to really stick it to the mayor and said 2 months before the election, effective this day, March 15th, we're no longer going to have an ambulance service. Forcing the city to do something, hoping the mayor would look bad. Well, the city started an ambulance service with 16 men, all EMTs. Actually, six of them EMTs. The other 10 were in class. And since 1977, our ambulance service has averaged somewhere in the neighborhood of 2,000 to 2,500 calls a year. In 1986, the guys from the ambulance service division were incorporated into the fire department and made firefighter EMTs or firefighter paramedics. And that's when we then established the opportunity to actually be promoted up in the ranks. So, you know, when I say I had almost 34 years on the job, 9 of those years were actually spent in the ambulance division, just strictly in that division. And then the remaining 25 years went on there. During this time, we formed different units within the department. Lenny and I were very proud to have actually kind of started, along with Terry Surrey, started the arson investigation unit, where we were able to nail a couple of pretty intriguing arsonists, I guess you could say. We established now the, what is it, Dave, that Cody's doing?
He's working as a SWAT medic, basically, with the ILIAS, which is the Illinois, Madison County, Illinois State SWAT team. He is the paramedic for them. He goes in just behind them to treat whoever they, whether it be an officer or a person they're trying to, you know, apprehend. But
so we have him involved in that. Dave himself and I think Tom O'Neill.
There's four of us.
Four of us now. Okay. They're still continuing the arson investigation, which to us is very important. Yeah, to us is very important because to us, as compared to the police, it's like a man with a gun going after a cop. You know, when somebody sets a fire on purpose, they want to hurt us. They don't care about us. So that's why arson investigation to us is very, very important. But the department is expanding. It's moving on, and it's bringing in new equipment. If you were to bring any of the new trucks down here, first of all, they wouldn't even fit under the doorway. Even if you went up to the curb, they might maybe fit in there, but they'd stick out another 8 or 10 feet. That's how much advanced these pieces of equipment are getting, and they're doing more and more multiple items at one time. So we're there. We have new ambulances on the streets, and we're hoping to get some other new ones
because some of them are starting to break down. But when you respond to over 2,000 calls a year, these ambulances, I mean, some of them have 140, 150,000 miles on them. And look, these guys, they work harder than firefighters do.
We average, the last couple of years, we've averaged 5,000 calls. And that's fire department and ambulance, you know, combined 5,000. The ambulance itself, on average, runs 3,500 a year.
Okay.
And then the fire trucks.
I have to make a lot of trips to St. Louis.
Right. They're making transfers in and out and everything else. So,
the department, I mean, as far as what you pay for through your tax dollars, you're getting a pretty good bang for your buck. And like Lenny said earlier, we're surrounded by volunteer departments. Now, we'll call them in, if we get something major like the warehouse fire. They came in, naturally for Lincoln Place Fire, they came in. When you get something major like that, you just have to pull in all your resources. But this department, is kind of the pride of Madison County and Southern Illinois. I mean, if you think about the advancements they've made, we were the first department to establish a paramedic service south of Aurora, Illinois, which is 20 miles outside of Chicago. And we've maintained it. Other departments have established it, and they've kind of let it go because of funding or costs or whatever. And I think right now the ambulance service is bringing in approximately $1 million a year in funds to the city. So it's profitable to a certain degree, but it's a necessity. And in this town, that has actually been the pride of the fire department, the ambulance service. Norma.
I can back you up on that. For 2 years, I was a technical supervisor for the fire safety classes that were offered at the school where I taught. And the firefighters came from all over, like Belleville, Fairmont City, Fairview Heights, St. Louis, even Granite City, Edwardsville. And all of the firefighters in those classes said that, boy, we wish we could get on in Granite City. It has such support from the city. Their equipment is fantastic. Their training is available. They just really admired the Granite City.
Which is why it's surprising to me that we have guys get hired on that quit and go somewhere else, like St. Louis or East St. Louis.
Actually, St. Louis just started their ambulance service, 5 years ago, 6 years ago, Larry?
Probably a little bit. Yeah. 6 years ago.
Yeah, I think right after... what's the name took over as chief?
Jankerson.
Yeah, Jankerson.
Yeah.
And they modeled it.
Oh, I got a story about
they modeled it after our fire department EMS program. Jankerson came here, looked at how we did it, what we did.
I was going to tell that story.
And he took it to St. Louis and said, this is what we're going to do. So the St. Louis EMS out of their fire department is modeled after the Grand City EMS division.
But he came over to teach us a tactics and strategy class to the captains. And he came over, and it was right before the warehouse fire, in fact. We hadn't had it yet. He started to teach class, and he told us all, he said, listen, we're going to have to delay the class for about a week or so. He said, I have to go and rewrite my class. He said, because in St. Louis, when they show up to a fire, they have like four guys that do nothing but take tools up, lay them on the front porch, and set ladders up, and then they're done. That's all they do. Then they have the interior attack guys that go in and they make a sweep, rescue and stuff, and they're done and they're out. Then they got the other guys going to put the fire out. Everybody's got a designated job. He looked at us and said, you guys do everything. He said, I don't know how to teach this class. He said, I don't. He said, because you guys have to do it all. You've got to take your 26. Own tools. You've got to set your own ladders up. You've got to go inside. You've got to do interior attack. You've got to do rescue. And you got to do overhaul and clean up afterwards. He said, I don't get it. And so he did. He had to go home and rewrite his class.
Their initial response team is 26 people, 26 firefighters. We have 13 on duty.
Yeah, so our first truck will be four guys.
Three stations?
Yeah.
We'll have four guys for a major house fire.
Yeah.
Originally show up.
But so, you felt safer being able to set up your own equipment than you would just having somebody set everything up?
We don't have a choice.
We don't have a choice. And it's the only way we were ever taught. We didn't know anything different.
Right.
He told us he's going to do this and do that. We're like, wow, that would be great to have somebody I could just say, hey, set my ladders up for me, I mean, it'd be awesome.
It would take Larry, longer for them to respond.
Oh, no. No, they're all their vehicles converge at one time, and they've got, St. Louis Fire Department is a very
professionally run department. They're well known throughout the country, and they've got it right down to the nats.
But
they really do. I mean, on their response, Larry, you're gonna.
I was just gonna throw something out here real quick. After I retired from the beer business, I got a job a couple years after that with a company down in Freeburg selling new fire engines and fire equipment. And these guys will tell you a lot better than I know it, but I learned it dealing with all these different fire departments. If you go to Collinsville, they fight fire and they have different ways of doing whatever they do on a daily basis than these guys do. If you go to Alton, those guys have a different way and process of doing things than these guys do and Collinsville does. Am I right or wrong?
Exactly.
The principle's the same. It's to save lives and put out the fire. But they've all, and a lot of it's tradition. Am I right?
Exactly.
A lot of it comes down from 100 years ago, and this is just the way they did it. But that's like what Lenny and Artie just said. They're used to making a call with four guys, you know, and the guys in St. Louis, they might have six trucks coming at one time.
Wow.
And then speaking of tradition, it's tradition where if after 4 o'clock in the afternoon, if we use a fire truck, we go on a run, the next crew the next day has to wash the fire truck, and they have to wash the wheels.
Yeah.
And the reason that started was because when the old horse-drawn would go, they would get the horse done on the wheels, so they had to wash the wheels. It's still a tradition. They still wash the wheels of the fire truck at 4 o'clock every day.
Fire trucks have the cleanest wheels all across the country.
Regardless of...
doesn't matter what department.
Trucks are made better now, but back, you know, not that long ago, a lot of rusted out wheel wells, too, because of all that water.
before aluminum, yeah.
Seriously.
And I've got to say this. You know, when I first started on the job, somebody told me, he said, you're gonna enjoy the job, but you're going to really love the camaraderie among the guys. Didn't really think about it too much. And all of a sudden, it wasn't that much longer after I came on. Hey, I'm going to roof my house. Any you guys want to help? Yeah, okay. You know, next you know, you're helping somebody roof a house or like Lenny's house. You're helping roof the house or you're going to do an add-on or you're going to do this, you're going to do that. And next you know, 7, 8, 10 firefighters show up to help. And to me, that was the best part of that department. Gene and I knew each other playing Quarry League baseball before I came on the job. I met Lenny on the job. You know, we became great friends. Nip Hagnauer, Terry Surrey. You know, I knew Terry before, but it just, you develop that relationship. I don't see anywhere else in the businesses.
Yeah, even the cops.
I just don't see it.
Cops don't like it.
You know, and when a firefighter dies on duty, you know how you always see they have the long procession and firefighters everywhere. This is so true. I mean, you know, for the three Alton guys. When they were killed on the job, there were trucks from San Diego, Colorado,
Boston.
I went to that one too.
All over
Canada. 4,000 firefighters were out in the middle of that street.
You know, and
walk in by.
I don't know how many,
because
how many you guys went. I went to that up
it's
there.
It's such a brotherhood, and you just don't see that. I don't see it anywhere else, and it's the one thing that I miss from that job. I miss the action. Of course, I don't miss the action at 3 o'clock in the morning or on a 20-degree temperature day like Lenny and I were when Lenny decided to take a plow down the steps.
You look at the
pictures,
it's minus 58. You look at these trucks. There's no cabs on any of these.
The coldest fire, we looked it up. The coldest fire we ever had was on Union Street across the highway there on West Granite.
Yeah.
And it was a double-wide trailer. The temperature that night was minus 15 degrees, and the wind chill factor was 64 below. Yeah. And I've got the news clippings at home, and we fought that fire nice and toasty and warm when we got there, because it was rolling. And then we put it out, and our hoses froze to the ground.
That's where we screwed up.
We had to take the axes and chop our hoses out. Luckily, there was a guy who was going to work. He was a welder. He got his torch out, and he heated up the couplings so we could separate them, and then we picked them up, couldn't roll them because they were full of water. We picked them up, tied a rope around them, hooked them to the back of the truck, and we drug them back to the fire station.
And we got back with our coats. They look like,
oh, yeah.
They look like these great big dresses that went out, you know, tutus, because they were froze. Our gloves were frozen to our hands, and we had to go in and water down with hot water just to get everything off.
Yeah.
I mean, that was the coldest fire ever. But talking about the camaraderie, you know, we spend 24 hours at a time with each other. And my wife, you know, she works during the day. I might see her for a couple hours in the evening, and then we go to bed. So out of 3 days, I might see her 6-7 hours. I'm with these guys 24 hours a day. So you're actually with these people more than you are any of your family at any
time. And sometimes you appreciate that more.
That's my wife.
So does she.
So does she, exactly, yeah.
And my wife said the same thing.
Stories about the paramedic part of it when that was founded. I lived in unincorporated Shoto Township, just off of West Chicken Rocks Road. My daughter had an epileptic seizure, and she was the color of Gene's shirt. And back then, when you called for an ambulance out there where I lived, you had the Mercer meat wagon, usually. And there were two Granite City guys that showed up at my house, and I asked them, how the hell did you get here so fast? There ain't no way. I says, which station did you come from? They swore to God they came from Station 1, and I think they were there in less than 10 minutes. And then, especially for the members of our group, Barry Gibb is one of our members. And the accident that was at Strohhard and Romine were involved in
27
was a fatality with a car, and that was Barry's wife's father and brother that died in that accident.
Yeah, it was the grandfather and the grandson.
Well, this is Charlie and his grandson. Yeah.
Yeah, and the fire truck hit him, and the fire truck ended up over by Johnny Bell's house, where that shirt place is.
Yeah.
And Strohide was laying in the front yard with his leg laying up here. He had broken his leg. And then Strohide, because of his injuries and stuff, a few years later, he had to leave the job. And then a few years later, he died from complications of everything.
I'd like to take a little break. I got quarter after 7. I'd like to take a little break so everybody can come on, get a cookie, some more cider.
Yeah, but in the past.
In the past, it actually was on-the-job training. And they taught you every one of that. You know, the guys on the job.
That's what my dad told me when he was hired. He told me, he said he come in, and he's in front of the alderman, and he said, they asked him, do you know what this is? He said, them are duckbill pliers. He said, you know where B Street, C Street, and A Street is? Yeah, that's, you know, Adams, Benton, and Cleveland at the time. Said, you know where this is? Yeah, I said, okay, you're hired. You know all that stuff. He knew a few tools, and he knew where some streets were. He was a taxi driver when he was 17. And so he knew where all the streets were, and because he knew where the streets were and all that stuff, and a couple
important
tools, that was the test. Now the test, well, first, you got to be a paramedic to be hired.
Yeah.
They won't even hire you now.
Yeah, you can't even be in school. You got to have that license.
Yeah, and that's how far they, I think, in the Navy, you have to be hired, or you
have
to be an EMT.
Well, they just changed it back. They just changed it back. You have to have your EMT license, and you have to be in school to be becoming a paramedic. And the paramedic is a year's worth of classroom work, and you have to have so many hours of field work, kind of an internship, more or less, with supervisors that are running on ambulances. And after, you know, it can go up to a year once they feel that you're comfortable enough to run on your own, then they pass you through.
A lot of that had to do with money. The city used to train you. It's Indian school now. That costs a lot of money.
Yeah.
But you also have to be a firefighter, too. You have to establish that position within the first 3 years on the job. So you're basically on a three-year probation. You're on a one-year probation coming on the job, but a three-year probation for getting your, you know, finishing your training and everything else.
We just don't
hire
where, in the
like
city
I said
too.
Before, you know, when I came on the job, everything was on the job training with the fire department. And they were pretty, you know, extensive in their training. I mean, the guys would each kind of have a specialty, and that's what they'd train you on. Rope tying, ventilation, fire suppression, fire rescue, you know, whatever it may have been, each individual kind of take over and train you on that. Well, now they were for a while sending them to U of I to the fire academy up there. Well, then I guess that got a little bit too expensive. I don't know if they're still doing that now, or
they're sending them through the
SWCC
academy.
SWCC academy, okay.
The 12-week fire academy.
Yeah, so, but at least they're still getting you that training because, you know, as one of our guys inappropriately put it, you put the wet stuff on the red stuff. Well, that's just not how we do it anymore. You know, there's some red stuff, you put the wet stuff on, it's going to blow the hell out of you. So
I remember a time when, and I ain't going to say who he was, one of the chiefs, air masks, my dad told me air masks were like something that they had, but you just didn't use them. Mm-hmm. Because they had to take them down to Granite City Steel to have them filled, because they didn't have a cascade system, you know, an air system to fill them. Well, we were at Steinberg Furniture Fire, and me and Mike Richardson kneeling down, and the chief come up and said, don't use them masks, it ain't that smoky in there, don't use them. We don't want to get them filled again, don't use them. And a row of smoke's rolling. I got a picture of the fire. Smoke's rolling out of there. Here we are, knelt down, and the chief tells us, don't use those things.
Yeah, save your air.
Now, you got to wear a mask. They want you to wear a mask, you know, on your way to the fire. You know, I mean, it's crazy. Yeah,
I can remember coming on, and the older guys didn't want to wear a mask because it wasn't manly.
Oh, yeah, my dad,
seriously,
they used to carry a handkerchief, you know, yeah, the plaid ones or whatever, the hobo handkerchief. They'd wet it, tie it around their head, and then suck it in, and they'd go in the fire, and that's what you'd do.
Anyway,
and one of the best smoke eaters in the whole country, from what my dad said, was Mick Hillman.
Yeah.
Mick Hillman, they would be in there, and a burning mattress is the worst smoke. We call that a lung cutter. It had just cut right through you. And it was a burning mattress in there, and all the guys are just watering, eyes watering, and they're gagging and puking and all that stuff. And he's standing in the middle of the living room smoking a cigarette, going, what's wrong with you guys? Let's go. Put this thing out. And he's smoking a cigarette. Good Lord.
Okay, let's take that break, and then we come back. And
there's a couple of fires where, you know, there's some close calls, and one of them was a Mount Zion church fire. Originally, Kenny Drewy and I went down in the basement three times. And when we came out the third time, Kenny said, I'm tired of putting that same fire out. Well, that pretty much tells you got problems. So then the fire started getting away and everything, and we're fighting it from different angles, and all of a sudden we see a fire in the third part of the building, just out of nowhere, no connection between the main fire and that one. But anyway, we get an order by the chief to take a inch and a half hose, or inch and three-quarter line, which puts out about 100 gallons a minute, into the front door and put the fire out. And we kind of looked at him like, are you serious? You know, I want you. Okay, fine. So we go and grab the line, and start to walk up, and I forgot my helmet. So I asked Lydia to grab my helmet. So he grabs it, and he's bringing the line up, and I get to the front door and open the line up, and I turn back to see where Lenny is with my helmet. When all of a sudden I noticed Lenny's eyes kind of get big like this. And just then a bunch of smoke started blowing by me, and I started feeling the heat. And like I've always said, I never know why I shut the line down, but I shut it and I started running towards Lenny. And as I was running, I could feel bricks hitting me. The whole front facade was falling forward. And just as I got close to Lenny, one of them caught me on the back of the leg, which caused me to trip, and I fell in Lenny's arms, fall on the ground. He rolls over to protect me.
So romantic.
They got married.
But there was kind of a tradition on the fire department
married a week later.
Yeah, where, you know, if somebody kind of saves you a little bit, you thank them by giving them a kiss. So while Lenny was on top of me, I reached up and I kissed him on the lips, which wasn't unusual at the fire department. But anyway,
I'm a little bastard kiss.
By the way, I was not a virgin when he kissed me at that time, because when I was young on the job, the upper level fire, remember the upper level nightclub?
Yeah.
That was Jesus' place. It caught on fire.
Yeah.
And we were sent up, me and Terry Surrey were sent up there with a line, and we got up there. Well, firefighters always go in as a team, two in. Always. You go in as doubles. Me and him got up there, and we got separated. And I couldn't find the line, and he couldn't find me. And we started crawling around just trying to get out of there. And both of us stepped out of the two doors that were on this balcony at the same time. I busted it open and stepped out and pulled my mask off, and he stepped out and pulled his off, and he looked at me and goes, Wilson! And he comes over and grabs me and goes, right like that! And that was my first kiss on the fire department.
But so that's kind of a traditional thing. You know?
Dane's laughing because he's been kissed before.
Yeah. and it was kind of ironic because you look across the street and there's two people, two of our fine residents, standing there going. And then a couple years later, we had an apartment fire right behind Clean Craft Cleaners on Madison Avenue. There was an apartment, we call it the apartment from hell, because it was a 7-hour apartment fire. You know, it's a 6-room apartment. But that day was also like 12 degrees outside with a minus something wind chill. And we were inside, Lenny, myself, and Sam, and we made it all the way to the back of the apartment. We could feel the heat. It was just black smoke. You couldn't see the guy in front of you. But you couldn't see any flames. I mean, you just couldn't. You knew they were there, you couldn't see it. And then all of a sudden, they start blowing the air horn outside, which means get out now, okay? So we turn around, and Lenny comes around, and he gets out in front, and we get to the steps. And like I said, you couldn't see in front of you. All of a sudden, it's getting real hot. And as I'm starting to go down the steps, I was kind of coming down like in a sliding on my belly type position. And I'm hearing what sounds like bricks falling off the building. And I'm thinking naturally that, okay, the building started to collapse. That's why they got us out of there. I come sliding down only to realize that the sound I thought was bricks falling down the building was Lenny going head over heels with his air tank on down the steps. Steps came down and they turned. He hit the wall and slammed and came back out this way. Well, when I get down there, I see him down there. I help him outside. I covered him up just as he covered me up. And then Sam came around and I called for an ambulance because I knew Lenny was hurt. And our chief at the time, which was a different chief, I'm not going to say smarter or not, but says, come on, we got to get him out. I said, you know, he just fell down the steps. Maybe hurt. Well, we got to get him out. I said, get an ambulance up here. Get a stretcher up here. But his whole idea was get him away. Well, anyway, so, you know, in the fire service, they tell you if you put out one of three items, you're going to extinguish the fire. You either smother it, you take away the oxygen, you take away the heat, or you actually remove the element that's burning. We call it a four-way thing. You remove the heat, you remove the air, you remove the element, or you remove the chief. You know, then you can put out a fire. Am I lying?
I ain't saying a word. The new chief is married to my cousin, so I'm not saying a word. It's family.
But anyway, now. But and speaking of that, I will say this week, and not to mention any names, but one of our guys who's currently a chief, his son had a serious heart condition. And they did an operation here, and then later on, what, 4 years later, 5 years later?
God, it's been 20 years.
He went out to Philadelphia to do an operation. Well, some of the guys called out there to let him know that, you know, one of the brothers were out there with his son for a heart operation. And those guys just, it was amazing. I mean, they did things like they put a ladder up to the window, firefighters crawled up, knocked on the window, waved to him. They came and visited him. I mean, it was just like they couldn't do enough for this firefighter's son who was out there. And that's the kind of camaraderie you just don't, you know, you don't get anywhere else. It's kind of located with us. So I'm done.
Hey,
talked enough.
Well, you know, and it's part of the history, the animosity between the firefighters and the ambulance service. It was not real good when the ambulance service started. And I know you guys probably don't want me talking about this, so I won't spend a lot of time on it. When the ambulance service started in 1977,
what are you doing down there?
Firefighters didn't like the ambulance service. In fact, for I don't know how many years it was, they weren't allowed in the station, the ambulance guys. They had to sleep in the basement at the hospital. They changed shifts down on the ramp or on the deck outside the station every morning. And that's about as much as I'm going to delve into that to show you that.
Well, I have to say I came on a year after the ambulance service started, my dad being a firefighter and everything, and he was still on at the time, and I got hired, and I come out, and these guys are like, set your cot up out in the engine room. I'm like, well, we got a dorm with beds. Oh, no, they sleep out in the engine room. They don't sleep with us.
Art came on at the beginning. He'll tell you he slept.
They disturbed the country club.
They made maybe 3 calls a week back then.
Yeah, that ambulance phone going off in the middle of the night woke them up.
One of the firemen told the assistant chief, George Smolens, he told him, George, you got to get that ambulance phone out of that dorm. Said it wakes us up at night. He actually said that.
We're disturbing them. Now, what they don't realize is that this ambulance service saved the fire department on three occasions politically. It really did.
It didn't matter. And this went
and they didn't, you know, they didn't realize it. All they knew is that we were a disturbance to their nice little quiet workplace. And
I'm sure,
and of course,
like that,
the more
it
happened, the you know, less we cared. In fact, we kind of went out of our way to make more noise.
Yeah.
Sometimes you turn the siren on before you leave the engine house. You know? Yeah. So it was kind of a little bit both ways.
I don't
ways.
Think it was just our department. This went on for a lot of years. I mean, a lot of years.
Yeah.
Though eventually they were, when I came on, yeah, you were allowed to sleep in the engine house. And
you were allowed to be human.
Yeah. When you were treated, you were still treated a little different though, but yeah, we'll let it go at that. Does anybody have any questions or any
questions?
Go ahead, John.
Today, when there's an ambulance call, doesn't the fire engine go with them?
Yes.
That's another good point, Norma. Back in the day, it was hard to get the truck out to help them. They didn't want to help the ambulance service. You know, the more guys you have at the scene of an ambulance run, the easier it is. You know, especially like on a heart attack when you're doing CPR and all that, to help bring in equipment or help doing CPR while the paramedics are doing their thing. The firemen now, as Dave will tell you, will be doing CPR. But now a lot of the firemen that are on the trucks have been on the ambulance, so that helps. Now these guys that are, you know, whether it be the pipemen or the engineers, even the captains, some of the captains now are probably
chief commanders. Even
our chief actually is still a paramedic.
Well, the chief and assistant chief are both paramedics.
Who's the chief now?
Vince Martinez. He was the guy we were talking about. His kid had a heart attack 20 years ago in Philadelphia. That's
it's a
the guy we're
thing,
talking about.
I can't
about.
Say nothing bad about.
Yeah, no.
Yeah.
I have a question for Larry.
Okay.
You said you and your dad restored this one, and you got that one basically in a bunch of baskets.
Yeah.
What does it take to restore it, and like, how long does it take?
It took about 4.5 years for this one. And pardon me?
You better get up here.
Oh,
yeah,
sorry.
He's sorry.
Okay. It took about 2 years on this one. It takes a lot of effort and a lot of time because if you're a person that has money, it's a different story because you can pay to have the work done. We did everything ourselves. And fortunately, I had friends, like with the painting. I had a buddy that was a painter. He painted it for me.
That's just kind of the gold leaf.
Yeah, just the gold leafing on this is how much?
This, I've never added it up.
It's over $3,000.
It's not gold paint. That's real
gold. Gold leafing. Yeah,
that's
goes
real
around.
Gold leafing.
Yeah.
That's all, because that's the way it was.
And that's tradition on the fire department, on fire equipment.
This truck, like I said, is real near and dear to my heart because of my childhood affiliation with it, plus the fact that it's Granite City. And being a born and raised Granite City boy, it means that much more to me. And when we did it, I wasn't going to do it just halfway. I wanted to do it exactly like it was when it came out of the factory. And Lenny already told you the story about the accident. There, the photos on the wall up there of the truck back at the factory in Elmira, New York, after the wreck. And then the picture below it is the rebuild photo. Because what they did, they totally rebuilt this rig. And we did it identical to what that picture shows right there. I went off of that picture. I also have the other side view at home. And we just patterned everything right after those photographs. Plus, I ended up getting the original factory spec book, which is worth its weight in gold to a restorer. A buddy of mine was at the factory and ran across it by accident somehow, I don't know. But anyway, I have it. And that helped because it told me every bolt and nut that went into that truck, how all the lettering was on it, the whole deal. So.
And you know what? As members of the fire department, past and present, we appreciate what Larry does. I mean, Grand City Fire Department on this truck, people look at that. You know, what Larry does here in the museum and everything benefits us as firefighters and the fire department. You know, he doesn't really realize it. I think that, you know, I mean, the guys say thanks and all that, but it truly means a lot to us what Larry does because it does promote our department and the historic value of our department. We have a great history, and if it wasn't for people like Larry, a lot of people wouldn't know. We've got some of our own guys that don't know because, you know, they weren't from here.
Mm-hmm.
But guys like Larry just make it great for us.
It's just always been an interest of mine. It's been a hobby of mine since I was a little bitty boy who was old enough to know what a big red truck was all about. And it's just, I at 63 years old, I'm still interested in the same exact things I was in when I was interested in when I was three. So sometimes it can be rough on the marriage, but you know, other than that, it's just been a good time. And like Artie said, it's my hobby, but I really enjoy the fact and I want to share this with people because it is important to me. You know, I, as a historian, I always tell people, if you don't preserve history, there is no history. It's just not there. So, you know, sometimes we can get carried away like I have in the last 30 years, but at the same time, you know, I think it's just part of life that we need to give more thought to. And I, like I said, little guys like that right there, that's what's important with me with these trucks and the stuff.
Yeah, you know, I've got, I guess, with all the fire department functions, the golf tournaments and the installation officers and the different things that firemen do together on their days off, plus, you know, chasing fire since I was a little kid, I've got over 17,000 photos of fires and fire department functions and stuff like that. And then Facebook came along, and I never, the only one that ever seen any of my pictures were my son. My youngest son is a firefighter down in Madison. And so me and him would look at all my pictures. My dad would come over. My whole basement is nothing but photos.
Well,
and
some of
fire
us at work, you bring an album into work, we'd look through them. But
and so now with Facebook, I've been placing, you know, the history of the fires. I've been putting all this stuff on Facebook other people to see, you know, because I want them to.
So is there any Facebook page?
Yeah, just type my name in and you'll see all my pictures, you know?
I talked to him about that.
She wants to know if you can link.
Yeah, can we link to your page from our Celebrate Granite City Facebook page? So
I don't see why not. You'll get some pictures of my grandkids too, but I mean,
we could probably handle that.
I have a love for firefighting and grandkids, so there you go. That's building, my two loves.
Do you think those bump in the night here?
Well, let me put it this way, and I'll share this with you folks. I decided one night I was going to leave home for the night.
Really? Or did she decide?
Well, it's kind of a funny story. I really wasn't running away, but I just decided, man, I got to get out of here. So anyway, make a long story short, I came down here, and I decided, I stopped a Quick Trip, and I got myself bologna and bread and all this camping stuff that I needed, you know, for my night out, and six pack of beer. That was before
the camping store.
Before everything, yeah, that's before everything stopped. But anyway, I came down here, and I'll tell you what, I don't know how in God's name the firemen slept in this building at night. This is the noisiest, shakiest. Every time crane goes down the track down there at the mill, boom, 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 and you hear it all night long. Buses running by. I didn't care for it.
Larry.
Besides, it was 106 degrees at 2 o'clock in the morning.
Have you ever slept with eight guys?
It's on the snoring.
Yeah, in the Army.
The snoring and farting and snorting and everything else that goes on, and you're worried about a few creeks, and you got to be kidding.
Well, I can imagine, but I do admit I was here by myself, and it was about all I could handle.
Snoring that rattled the windows.
The big snorers.
Well, and that's probably true, because you probably, in the case that Lenny's talking about, you probably never hear the gantry cranes at the mill or any of that going on, or slab dropping.
My first night on the job, I was wide awake and scared to death because I'm by Eddie McGovern and Bob Bell, and both of them are racking it so loud, and I'm like, and you know what, I learned how to sleep with people snoring, which I never could before, and it was the best thing really for me, because I ended up learning how to sleep.
Well, I got a story about Bob Bell since you brought him up. Bob Bell could scream at anything, and I'm on the ambulance over at one of the few times the West Granite Station had an ambulance in it, and I guess it was time to get up the next morning, And he comes in, and since we have a kid here, I can't say it, but he said, he screams at the top of his lungs, "What the F do you think this is, a hotel?" You know?
He's screaming at you.
Screaming at me. I mean, as loud as he can, you know?
Instead of just walking up and saying,
"Hey, time to get up. You know, I'm new around here, you know? You know, what the F do you think this is, a hotel?"
But no, it's...
Of course, I sat straight up in bed, you know?
You know, there are a lot of good stories and some sad stories about the fire department and the firefighters. But overall, it's a great experience. And I'm glad, again, I'm going to say this, I'm glad Larry has this going because... You know, and I'm going to talk to him about this afterwards, but I think more of our firefighters need to get involved in coming down here and helping do some things.
Yeah, what hurt the fire department? We used to hire strictly just from Granite City.
Oh,
and when we couldn't find, when the pool of paramedics ran out in Granite City, well, the city had to go look elsewhere. So they looked. That's why they opened it up to outside the Granite City. But
I knew you were in trouble.
If you don't, well, your brother will put it in Granite, but...
And again, talking about the fire department, if you guys want to, if any of you want to find out some of the history, this lady by the name of Betty Richardson, she wrote this book, 150 Years of Firefighting in Madison County. Now, I forget what year she wrote it. Do you remember, Larry?
84.
She came through the fire department, and of course, somebody had to help her get stories for our department. So they sent me. And I went to the library, and I sat down with the microfilms of all the newspapers and everything, and I read every newspaper from 1903 on. And some of the stories were absolutely phenomenal. And if you want to read that, a lot of my stories that I collected for her, not my stories, but I collected for her out of the paper and gave to her, she put in this book. And it's awesome. And one of them was a guy, a firefighter by the name of Edward Friday. That was his name. He got hurt all the time. And I would read these stories about him. They're going to a fire, and the horses had come undone from the wagon and pulled him off, and he rolled into a telephone pole. He was on the ladder changing lights at the city hall, and he fell off the ladder and broke his wrist. I mean, this guy, finally, one of the captions was Friday hurt on Saturday. That was the way that he was hurt so much, that's the way they did it. But I read about this guy, and he was hurt all the time, but he was a good firefighter, and I contacted the family looking for, like I told you, I was looking for badges and stuff. The guy lived to be 96 years old and was still drinking whiskey, smoking cigars, and chasing women right before he died. So,
now, you know, it's
something to be said, I guess.
When you're a fireman?
You know, one of the things I said earlier, and I would mention to the group, was... You know, we talk about headlines, like Lenny said, Friday hurt on Saturday. One of the best, though, was at somewhere around 1 o'clock in the morning, fire broke out at a grocery store in Granite City. Happened to be right across the street from the main fire station called Big G Supermarket. It was an electrical fire that started in the walls, made its way up to the roof. Well, once it got into that 80-year-old roof, it took off. Once the firefighters get a call, Lenny's got pictures of it. It's a ball of fire when the firefighters pull across the street. It's already a ball of fire. And our illustrious press record at the time, giving all this credit to the fire department, states in the headlines, "Firefighters save parking lot at Big G Supermarket." You know, so I mean,
I remember that.
Yeah, and I mean, that's, you know, we talk about headlines and stories and everything.
That's what I tell everybody. We ain't lost a lot yet.
Yeah, we haven't lost a parking lot yet.
They've never lost a well or a basement.
They've saved a lot of basements.
But Norma.
Here's an idea for the new tradition to start at the fire station, and that is when you hire new firefighters, why don't you bring them down here? Let Larry introduce them to the history. And that'll ground them.
Yeah, we would like to do that.
Yeah.
And Dave probably knows too. When these guys were hired, when we were all hired, I was a member of a Wilson family who I have 32 cousins here in town.
All right. More than likely, my dad and my cousins and that stuff, no matter what house I respond to at a fire or if I back up on an ambulance or something like that, I'm going to know somebody or I'm going to know somebody that knows that person. And these guys, same way, hired, you had to live in Granite to be hired. But because of the professional, it's hard to find paramedics, you had to go out of town to find them. Well, I hate to say it, Dave would probably tell you, but a lot of guys, they come in, they clock their card, they put their 24 hours in and they go home. They don't care. They're not from this town. They don't have the love for its history that we do.
That's the point I was trying to make.
You know, yeah, that's That's the difference. You know, we grew up in this town. I was on my bicycle chasing my dad at fires, you know, taking pictures with my little 110 camera. I mean, I was, you know, that was my history with it. And so, but they just don't have the love that we have. I mean, I don't know a lot of the new guys now, but, you know, it's just not the same.
But you're right, Norm. That would be a good idea to bring them down here, indoctrinate them into the history by showing them this. It's just, you know, you hope that it sinks in. That's all. You can't.
There's no rule saying you've got to know the history of where you work. It's just a job. They're just collecting a paycheck.
Yeah.
Put their 24 in and go home.
Any other questions?
Some of them. Now I'll be online video that they can be educated with.
Well, we started a little educational thing, and it seemed like it was more of a hassle. You know, guys are sitting there.
This is just one part of the city.
I'd rather be taking a nap. And
I'd do this for the police department if I knew where to start. Police department was back here, but I mean, guys.
Same with the street department. I mean, look at what the guys have went through. We used to have our own trash trucks and our own trash service.
Yeah.
Now everything's contracted out.
Right.
They don't pour concrete sidewalks or pave streets anymore. They contract out companies and that stuff. And it used to be the street department under Lionel Partell and people like that. They ran it all. You know, they did it all. And I think our city was better for it. I really do.
I've got to be a cost item.
And one other thing that's always been a tradition, always, this pole. Every Saturday you had to, you know, brass and grass. You had to cut the grass, shine the poles, okay?
Right.
And
every Friday,
I'm sorry.
Every Friday. Right,
yeah. And we had to polish them.
So you can slide better or just because it was busy?
You got to be able to slide them.
You got
to
slide them.
The brass so looks, be slick.
The brass looks better if it's...
Yeah. If you try to slide that one right now, it'd be...
You try to slide down
stop.
On a bare arm.
Well, if you notice, there's a guy stuck up there. Yeah. He cannot make
See,
it all the
time. He hasn't made it down yet.
Yeah, he's still stuck.
I think it was just busy work.
I'll tell you what, at 3 in the morning, when you're waking up, an alarm goes off, and you just went from laying in bed to hanging from the ceiling by your fingernails because the alarm just scared the crap out of you. And you got a... 3 in the morning, try to find that pole and then try to slide down it the right way.
The main station had 3 poles down there. This is one of them.
Yeah. And we've had a couple incidents where the guy grabs a pole and steps out and doesn't wrap his feet and comes down at maybe 60 miles an hour, hits the floor and, you know, crashes. And
there's one pole left.
Richardson, that's it. And I will tell you this. When that incident happened, this guy did a great cartoon on it. So, you know, it's whenever you do something wrong, naturally there's a cartoon coming out about it. It's just
the first incident that fell down, that was in front of a tour going on.
Yes, yes, it was.
And the people clapped. They thought it was great. He missed the pole and hit the ground. Our guys pick him up, throw him on the stretcher in the ambulance in the hospital, and they're going, that was awesome looking.
And it was real. In the cartoon that Lenny does, there's a kid saying, "Mom, or is that the way they're supposed to come down the pole?" And the mom responds, "Why, of course, son. These men are professionals."
Oh, you're going to get me in trouble now. They're all going to see this.
Well, I should have brought some of the cartoons down because, he's drawing a cartoon. Him and one of the other guys, Pete Talley, I mean, they could draw some cartoons.
Yeah.
Here's a question for all of you. Does anybody know the name of Granite City before it was Granite City?
Granite.
No. It was Kinderhook. The name of the city was Kinderhook, and then in 1896, they changed the name to Granite City.
There was originally just called Granite.
Now, there's a guy, I can tell you a story about this chief, that's Lige King. And I was just telling somebody earlier, they asked what his name was, and I said, he was infamously known for yelling up and saying, "How many of you guys up there? There's 3 of us. Well, half of you come on down." You know, and again, like I said, you have the 4 elements of a fire. And again, if you just remove the chief, most of the time you can put the fire out.
Your first day on the job, you're not expecting anything. You're nervous because it's your first day on the job, whether it's on the ambulance or you're a fireman. Usually the first day on a job, now you're on the fire truck. They don't start you out on the ambulance. They give you
time to acclimate to the fire department, there's going to be jokes on you all day long.
Yeah, because they didn't see.
Whatever, like out of station, one of the satellite stations out, like on Johnson Road, they'll tell him to go get something out of the basement. Well, there is no basement. You ever see the U-shaped fluorescent bulbs? They'll tell you, go get some of those four-footers and bend them because we need a new one.
And you could pretty much tell how the guy's going to work out. If he goes to look for a bulb and try and bend it, or if he just looks at you, you know. Yeah. So you can pretty much tell real quick,
you know, how it'll work out. They'll see how skittish you are. They'll come up from behind you and tongue you in the ear. If you jump, well, three or four guys are going to jump on you then.
It's all that kissing you guys do. Well, starts with a little ear.
Yeah, we like each other.
Okay, blowing a guy's ear, that's, you know, what happens next, yeah.
But they're, yeah, I mean, they're, this room
is just after 8 o'clock.
This room is just full of history. And it's
yeah, really like is. I said, we couldn't touch on everything, but we hope we gave you an idea of the history of this town. Thanks to Art and Lenny and Larry for hosting us tonight.
Quite welcome. Nice of you to come down.